evening and welcome to Acton TV sports coverage of Acton Boxborough Colonial Football as the Colonials get set to take on the Cambridge Falcons here. And Mark, here we are. It's the season opener. We're at Russell Field and it's a brand new game. So I'm excited about the season and we'll be right back after a word from our pregame sponsor, Life Care Center of Acton.
At the time, maybe you were just building a bridge, a business, or a community. Maybe you were simply working for a home or a better tomorrow. At the time, you served out of duty and love of country. But in that time, we see a legacy created, an American dream lived. The rehab team at Life Care Center of Acton is ready to help you live well.
Welcome back to Acton TV's coverage of Acton Boxborough Colonial Football. Now it's time for the Life Care Center of Acton pregame show.
Happy New Year, Mark.
Happy New Year. This is New Year.
Absolutely.
This is New Year to me, isn't it?
It's been way too long a summer. It's a new season, a new opening opponent with Cambridge, Grinch Latin, Falcons here. And I'm just all excited, Mark. And I know you've been doing research since the, ice out.
I'll tell you, since Thanksgiving Day, I've been on the internet looking at stuff. I got to first talk about last year's Thanksgiving game, which was, I think, one of the most exciting football games, Thanksgiving or otherwise, or Super Bowl. It had more highlights in that game than there was in the rest of the season. It was a great win for AB.
It is, and to have that kind of game at Thanksgiving is just a great way to send the kids off into the off season to be prepared for this very game tonight.
Well, I'll tell you, Cambridge is going to be a very tough opponent. They play in the Greater Boston League, and they play Everett every year. And last year, they played Everett really tough for three quarters. They gave up a couple of late touchdowns, but they were 7-4 last year. There's a question as to, just exactly the strength of their schedule. The four games they lost, they gave up about 160 points. So their defense might be vulnerable, but in our pregame conference with Coach Gallant, he said that he and advanced coach Mark Smith had never seen a group of faster skilled players in their about 60 years of scouting combined.
That's fast.
So we've got really a big challenge, and they are really led by their number one player here who's taken over at quarterback. And his name is Cameron McMillan, and he's taken over for the quarterback last year, who threw for 31 touchdown passes. It's a completely different look. He's a read option quarterback, and he's got a lot of people at his disposal. Number one is Shaquille Anderson. He scored 16 touchdowns last year, and we watched him. We think that he might have like sub 4.4 speed.
He was running post patterns, in warm-up. And, it's not often that you see speed when an athlete is just warming up.
Yeah,
but
it's crazy.
But he just looks fast.
He's got crazy speed. And then in the backfield is number 34, Sebastian Robert, who also has tremendous speed. And once again, he's a guy who can also have a combination of speed and power. He can go to the outside. And really, what they're trying to do here in Cambridge is to simply get their athletes out in space. Yeah. That's what they want to do. They want to create space. You're going to see a lot of flies. You're going to see a lot of bubble screens to the backs where one block is going to just get them going, and it's going to be speed, speed, speed. And our job is to really, we use the word contain. You talk about your cornerbacks, you talk about your secondary, and we're really going to have to contain and keep the edge. And the other thing we're going to have to do is really hold on to the ball and just play some smash mouth with these guys.
Yeah, I agree, Mark. And on the Acton Boxborough side of the ball, what's exciting about this season is a lot of these kids, the core of this team, are kids that we saw last year. I mean, you really have a good appreciation. I mean, they're kids that were playing as juniors and sophomores last year, and now you get a chance to see them just grow one more year as athletes, as student athletes. And you start off with Hunter Arnold, who's been playing quarterback since he was 3 years old,
yeah,
I think.
Yeah,
And what I like about Hunter Arnold, it's number 12, is that he just keeps his eyes downfield. He just has nerves of steel, runs the wing tee with perfection, and I'm just really excited to see how he plays. He'll be playing quarterback and safety. And then, you know, just think about who is around Hunter as athletes. You go, you got Will Tejeda, terrific athlete, you know, fastest player on a team, they say. And, you know, there's a lot of fast kids, but, you know, Will really, you'll see him at running back, you'll see him at wing back, you'll see him, you know, all over the defense in different positions at corner, typically, and so on. And Tom Sapinero is what many say, you know,
he
really
is just a football player's football player. Yeah,
exactly.
Yeah.
Got great speed as well and just a very durable guy. And then, you know, in addition to Tom, we got JT Kelly and Barry Wolfson, just great. You know, JT Kelly running back, a little corner. Wilson, co-captain, basically on the line, both sides of the ball, just big, strong player as well. So these kids have been playing for a while, and I expect this core to carry on the tradition of blue and gold.
Well, that's right. And when talking with Coach Gallant, he really feels that this team is a playoff team. And I want to talk a little bit about the fact that everything has changed in Eastern Mass football this year. They're going to a completely different playoff format. Much like field hockey or soccer, where you don't have just a few teams playing. You've got really the first and second team in each league, as long as it's a five-team league, is going to make the playoffs. So the season is really only a seven-week season, Tim, which means that on October 27th, all the seedings will be set for the postseason. One of the crazy things about this is that because of that, we wind up playing Westford twice. We play them during the regular season to determine the playoff seeds, and then we keep them as our traditional Thanksgiving rival. However, we've lost Concord, who we've played since, I think, 1689, and Wayland, who we love to hate.
That's right.
The problem is that we have a lot of old rivalries that are really falling by the wayside with this new playoff format. But it's going to put a lot of more teams into the postseason, which is really what the coaches and the players were looking for. Acton-Boxborough has got the fourth best record in Eastern Massachusetts since the year 2000. 83% of games it's won. And that's one of the reasons why I think it was put in Division I. Now, Cambridge was put in Division II. Acton-Boxborough is the only DCL team in Division I. You've got teams like Everett, Bridgewater Raynham, Catholic Memorial, St. John's, Xaverian, Brockton, and Chelmsford. And then you have Acton-Boxborough in Division I. So we're playing with the big boys, and it's going to be a very interesting season.
It's big steps for big steppers here, you know. So I think, you know, we got everything. There's a lot of change in the air, new playoff system, new opening season opponent. You know, we're in Division 1A, it's all big leagues. We got pizza here, we got Hawaiian, we got cheese, we got pepperoni down there, we got the whole shooting.
We got lighting even.
Absolutely, we got lighting. I hope, you know, that does
That might be worse than better.
But, you know, with all that, what do you say, Mark?
Hey, let's play some football.
Every day, kids witness bullying.
Why are you stabbing me with it?
No.
They want to help, but don't know how. Teach your kids how to be more than a bystander. Visit stopbullying.gov.
Today's game is brought to you by Gallant Insurance Agency and by the Steinberg Lally Charitable Foundation and by these fine sponsors.
All right, Mark, here we go. It's turned out to be, so far, a beautiful night. There's a little bit of, there's a big threat of rain later on.
Yeah, absolutely, perfect night. We're supposed to have 70 mile an hour winds, but it's gorgeous right now.
Will Tejeda and JT Kelly back deep for the Colonials. And it's off. They kick a squib down the middle and it rolls to Will as he goes and cuts up the middle and he pounds up to about the 37-yard line. First and 10, Colonials.
And Will was actually, a couple days ago, he was really doubtful for this game with the ankle sprain, and they've been just trucking in ice from Canada, from Nova Scotia, and he's been icing all week, and he looked very good in warm-ups.
First and 10 on the 38.
All right, first and 10, the Colonials with their wing tee offense. Been polished up over 3,000 years.
Got a lot of veterans now in this backfield.
Hunter Arnold at quarterback. And up the middle is a big time run.
All right, that is Zach Douglas.
Or Gabe Cormier
with
that
Gabe
run.
Cormier.
Up the middle, right? And just holding on to the ball, Cormier, both hands, and going across midfield to the 48-yard line.
Really good line play in that on that first series there.
First and 10, Colonials cross midfield in Falcon territory. Little cross pump as Tejeda with a ball
down. And there's a fumble on the play. And it looks like Cambridge recovered.
Let's see.
All right, Cambridge ball.
The first turnover of the game right out of the gates with 10:14 to go in the first quarter. The Falcons recover.
It looked for a minute like maybe Tejeda had been down as forward progress was stopped because he was there for a while. But then that ball popped loose, and now this vaunted Cambridge offense takes the field. Cameron McMillan is the guy that makes it all happen, number one. Oh, there's a false start.
Flag on the play, it's a false start. Going to go against
false
Cambridge.
Start. They had McMillan, of course, a quarterback, and Shaquille Anderson as the running back there. They'll also put Robert in there.
Yeah, Shaquille Anderson's number one. McMillan
first
is number two.
For the Falcons on the 40.
McMillan getting the play from the coach. They take a long time between plays. So even though they run a spread offense, you know, usually teams like that are pretty fast at the play turnover, but this is going to be a very slow pace in terms of bringing in plays from the sidelines. This time, number four, Joseph Kozlowski in the backfield with McMillan. He changes sides.
There's another flag.
They give it to Shaquille, and we get him in the backfield in motion. There's a lot of mistakes. Very disorganized look for the Falcons out of the gates, Mark. And I'm bringing up. Looks like, see if they change this. They're going to repeat first down, or are they going to make it second and 15?
Yeah, they're going to take the penalty, because that's a...
It is. It's going to be second and 20.
Athens Boxborough decides to decline the penalty.
Okay. So that motion call made the play stand.
On the 34. 29, correction.
They spread him out, McMillan. With Kozlowski in the backfield, and you get trips left. AB running a 5-2. McMillan looks to in the flash,
oh,
and well.
And the pass.
Not even close. That
Anderson
pass
threw
was...
a pick on.
Yeah, he did.
He threw a pick. I think he did it on purpose. The Saponaro Sap was going to pick that off and take it to the house.
Yeah, no. He wanted to get a little separation from Sap there. But it was a nice tight spiral. It was about 10 yards too high. And now they're really backed up with about a third and 21. Now their deep threat is number 19, Elijah Booker. He and the other Elijah Scott last year, combined for 17 receiving touchdowns, more than any other duo in Massachusetts. But of course they had a great quarterback throwing to them.
Kozlowski in the backfield. McMillan back deep. He's going to throw the ball deep. It's a big,
and
lot of air. Ball basically out of bounds as it hit the sideline there. Not a very accurate pass. Not a good release either.
Yeah, but he was pressured into that. And you could see the speed of Elijah Booker, number 19, as he was coming down the field. He almost caught up with that pass, too.
But I'll tell you, out of the gates, Mark, it doesn't, they don't look crisp with this offense so far. I mean,
no, and they,
we're
and
used
they really...
to seeing, you know, it, when you see Waylon run this offense, they look, you know, they just look crisp. They,
yeah,
they look
they
very
didn't,
organized.
They didn't look that crisp in pregame warm-ups either.
So let's see, Deshaun Velez, and I saw him warming up. He's got a pretty good foot.
Okay, we got JT Kelly.
And a good boot.
Going to, oh.
Whoa. Uh-oh. And the ball's loose, and
oh,
it's recovered by the
balls are covered by
Colonials. Oh, boy.
Oh, my goodness.
And thank God
thank
for
Kyle Anestis on the
they will spot the ball
recovery.
On
that ball was just all over the place.
Correction 23.
From the opening minutes here, Mark, you'd think it would be a wet field, but it's dry
yeah.
so far.
You know, Cambridge has won game. They played last week. They won easily 45-20 against Greater Lawrence Tech. So this they've had a little game experience. This is the beginning for AB.
Dylan Caldwell is the single back as they run a they look at like they're in fly formation. They go up the middle. Nothing there.
All right, this time they're stopped.
Colonials will run it for a short game.
Now, Tim, I think you're going to see a little bit more misdirection this game. They've got a couple of linebackers that really focus on the ball that may not make great reads. So I'm looking for some more counters, a little misdirection, perhaps a bootleg by Hunter Arnold at some point.
Nothing there. It's well covered by the Falcons as that was Tejeda
and number
over
seven,
the right side.
Tejeda on the run for a gain of about two.
Okay, so we've got about a third and six. Third and a long five right now.
You see see the Falcons adjust from that first series where it seemed like they, you know, we were really opening up some holes on attack in the middle. Sapanero out wing in motion. They go the opposite way. Nope, it's a pass to Tejeda, and it's complete for a first down and more to the 40-yard line.
That,
what a great pass by Hunter Arnold.
That was too easy, too easy. And they look like they could do that all night long, that short pass out in the flat about 6-7 yards. And once again, we're watching Tejeda, and he's looking good.
The lot of personnel changes with this AB offense, more than usual. So just trying to get used to all the changes, folks.
Yeah, you got Matt Carter in there.
Yeah.
Yeah, they're using everybody.
First and 10 on the 40.
Gabe Cormier at fullback. Tejeda on a little wing back.
Oh,
and he just gets
tripped
up. He almost had six there.
Down after a gain of about 3 yards.
Oh,
but 3 yards, that's a good gain. That'd be second and 7.
Yeah, that was Jeremy McCall on the stop there. And that was the, you know, you get through one, you're going all the way.
7 on the 43 for Colonial.
Got number 81, Jack Foster, playing tight end this year along with Jack Hoggard. Boy, Jack came on like gangbusters last year, didn't he?
He really did. The pitch that Tejeda, as he gets outside, he cuts up the slot. And well,
stop
there.
After a gain of about 2 on the play. A gain of nothing on the play. Bring up 3rd and 7.
Yeah,
timeout
AB. Now, as we said, this is a team that really pursues to the ball very well, which is why I think you're going to be seeing some more counters. They've got great team speed in the secondary. They have 6 players going both ways, and 4 of them are their skill players. My God, they won the 200-meter track relay last spring, and 3 of those 4 players are on the field right now. So you can tell what kind of speed they have.
I also think with this kind of team, I know the linebackers go fly to the ball, but usually can run right at them. And like that first series, it looked like that. So I just think a little bit of confidence, get the blocking scheme adjustments in place, and we should be able to go right at this team. right, Tejeda, he's got a little room in the flat, and he's going to pound across midfield for a first down as he turns on the Jets.
I'll tell you, he knew exactly where that first down marker was, and he decided to beat it by about 6 inches.
Little speed on speed, you know. It's we got a little bit of speed on our team too. It's great to see the match up there.
And this is a kid who can't possibly be 100% tonight. There's just no way he's playing at 100%.
Yeah, but you got Mr. C, our secret weapon.
Mr. C, yes.
He's like Dr. Frankenstein. He brings people, athletes to life somehow, you know. All right, first and 10, just across midfield. And it's a Delaware off to the right as Tejeda gets up the sideline and does a tightrope for about 6 or 7 or 8 yards here. Let's see where they spot the ball. It's 5 yards.
That's a great 5-yard run. There's no way that I thought that he would make the edge on that. But he did it, and as you say, he just went right along that sideline and made some positive yardage.
He took a subway to the Lexington and took it right up the sideline there. It was great. Oh, that's right. We're in Boston. I was in New York right there. But anyhow, sorry, folks.
Boylston. There's a counter.
There's the counter with Saponeros. He cuts back up. He's got a second effort. The ball's loose, and he gets it back.
Oh, my goodness. 3 fumbles in about 5 minutes.
It's opening day here, but it's clear that the Falcons are going for the ball. They get one player on it, and they're really – they've been – this is by design. Coaching.
Well, that counter play has been a real nemesis for us for the last couple of years because it requires really great timing, a great blocking scheme, and really, frankly, the last couple of years it just hasn't worked that well. This year it's been working very well in practice and very well in scrimmages.
I know it's your favorite play other than the bootleg.
The bootleg is my favorite play.
All right, third and about 3. Up the middle, and a good slide off for close to a first down.
That's going to be, I think, about 6 inches short.
Goes Gabe Cormier.
And they're gonna go for it on the 40-yard line, no question at all.
Fourth and about a yard.
Bring up fourth and 1.
You know, this is where we could use Tom Brady. Speaking of which, is there another team that's playing in Foxborough tonight?
Certainly nothing.
I'd rather be here.
Absolutely.
I'd rather be here. I've got Rebecca DVR in the game, and I'm going to be in total isolation on my way home.
All right, we line up in a flex.
Oh! That hurts. That hurts. That puts us in a punting situation.
There's a flag on the play. It'll be a false start against Akron Boxborough.
A lot of mistakes on both sides of the ball early on,
yeah,
Marcus.
Going
to bring up 4th and 6 on the 45.
Yeah, very, very choppy so far. Now, Hunter Arnold is going to be doing the punting this year. He's doing a rugby punt, which gives us an opportunity to always have him run rather than punt. And he's got the green light whenever he feels he can make it to do that.
And he gets the ball down to the sideline, not going to risk any returns.
Very nice punt. He pins him all the way down,
and it's still rolling, and it's still rolling down to about the 3-yard line.
I don't think 5 yard line.
Yeah,
you won't see a better punt in Foxborough tonight than you just saw from Hunter Arnold.
So let's say
punt will be downed at the 5-yard
line. 55-yard punt.
With a Falcons will pick it up. 50-yarder, anyhow.
the public address announcer just mentioned that it's going to be Patriots ball. I know where his head is at.
By the way, Rick, who's in the van. Just has his hands in so much of this operation. He doesn't want to know anything about the Patriots score tonight, Mark. So.
Oh, good. Neither do I.
If you look at your.
We're going to concentrate on this game.
All right, 1st and 10 for the Falcons, as they fake a fly and do a keeper up the middle, and.
Good gang tackling, but good yardage there.
Shaquille Anderson with the ball, darting in and out for about 5 yards. Very tough character to bring down.
Yeah, you want to keep Anderson in the middle of a lot of AB defenders. You don't want him in space. But tackling was a real big issue in that last scrimmage we had against Wayland. A real deficiency that's got to be cleaned up tonight.
Well, if you're going to play Cambridge, it's a good team to practice against, is Whalen. All right, Anderson's in the slot.
You've got DeMond split out right, number three. Watch him.
McMillan with the keeper up the middle, and he's gets about another 4 yards. Let's see what he got. What did mark it?
All right, Kyle Anestis came right in on that. Made a great stop. Great stop.
2 yards. Bring about third and about 3 yards. At about the 11-yard line.
And I like the way they're closing. Like the way they're closing on Anderson. You know, it's very tough for a read option quarterback. He's really got to make two reads. One read right at the beginning before the ball is snapped to see what the defense is like. And then his second read as he's running with the ball.
All right, they try a little bubble pass, and it's incomplete.
And
it was a forward pass. And interesting play call. You know, just not a good throw, and you know, from what I've seen in the warm-ups, not the kind of throwing accuracy to run that bubble screen reliably.
Yeah, it certainly appears that way. And as you say, it was a very odd play call on third and fairly short when you have such speed and such a running attack. And we just haven't
that read option. You got a first
exactly,
down.
Exactly. And we really haven't seen them run the fly yet.
Nope.
And
all that speed.
They don't see. And Kozlowski, number four, is in the backfield, and he's typically their defensive stalwart. You don't see him typically in the backfield. So I don't know if one of the players is banged up a little bit or there's some injury issue.
JT Kelly back.
20-second timeout for the Falcons.
For the punt for the Colonials, and it is kind of it's odd. It's they don't look crisp.
No, not at all.
They're running a skill offense, and it doesn't seem like they have the skill. I think they have the speed, but
yeah. When you mention Whalen and quarterback like Ben Cherry, I mean that was a great option offense. I think JT Kelly's going to make a few runs and returns that are going to make you maybe forget Billy Jackman a little bit or remind you of Billy Jackman a little bit.
And a good,
good
punt.
Good punt, yep.
I thought JT Kelly might have been a little bit too far, and he catches the ball and fields it carefully at 49-yard line of the Falcons. So we start in Falcon territory. I think it's all about just collecting ourselves and running mistake-free football. And I think we can move the ball against these Falcons from what I've seen so far.
Well, given the fact that we've fumbled three times and we've lost one, it still feels that we're controlling the game so far with 2:49 to go in the first quarter.
All right, first down. Sapanero wing. We run to Haydon. Nice 36 powers. He pounds out for 9 yards. Good old-fashioned A.B. Wing T football there.
My God, that reminds me of last year. I'm getting that old excitement back. That was last year's Thanksgiving game.
It's nothing like that play.
Number seven just flying through the pack at any moment can break it for a touchdown. That's exciting football and great line play. Great blocking schemes.
Second and one. The ball on the 39-yard line of the Falcons.
And we do not have a big O-line for sure. We don't have any more of those 270-pound kids anymore.
And again, is that Cormier up the middle?
Yeah, that's Gabe.
Gabe's running really nice.
Cormier.
He runs very low, quick.
After a gain of four.
Short, choppy steps, you know, picking his way up there. Looking good.
Now, when you have Sapp and Tejeda and Cormier and Kelly, you've got a really good group that complements each other with different running styles. 32.
First and 10. And there's Sapanero. He gets a dart. He's got one man to beat for a touchdown. He goes all the way up to the 6-yard line. What a run. Zigging and zagging.
introduced to Tom Saponaro.
Well, if you want to look at a combination of speed and power, and you want one play to exemplify that, that's that play. They're all the way down to the 7-yard line. It's going to be first and goal for the Colonials, looking to make their first score of this young season here.
First and goal. The ball's on the, looks like the 6-yard line, and Tejeda is a flag on the play as he runs into.
He is stopped for a loss.
That's a hold on AB.
A flag on the play.
Run blitz.
And they're going to take that penalty and move us back 10 yards. And it's going to be first and goal from the 17-yard line. First down.
All right, so they spot the ball on, get a better look at it now. About the 17.
Right on the 17. Yep. First and goal.
First and goal from the 17.
Okay, we got Matt Carter split out left.
Little counter up the middle as Cormier pounds his way up for about 10 yards.
Cormier is a strong kid.
What a great play there. It was just, you know, I was surprised I followed that play. You know, that was tough to follow there. A little reverse pivot counter.
But you gotta look at guys, you gotta look at guys like Barry Wolfson and Perk and the holes that they're opening right now. Boy, Perk has really come a long way as a football player. He is a football player.
Oh, Tejeda stopped in the backfield.
Yeah. Once again, number 88. That's Nathan Workman on the stop.
Third and goal on the 8-yard line.
And that'll bring up third and goal on the 8 for the Colonials.
All right, no problem. We can average 4.5 yards a carry and make this a touchdown. All right.
Okay, once again, look for Tejeda out in the flat.
Trips right. Tejeda fake the fly. Arnold back to pass. He throws the ball over to
Bill.
In and out of the hands.
Incomplete. And that'll bring up.
Whoa, Jack Hargett almost had that after, I think it went through the hands of Matt Carter.
Back shoulder throw looked like there. He had a few receivers open on that flood there. It was a flood to the corner. Timeout, or is that the quarter?
That's the quarter. I think.
What's up, coach?
How you doing?
Mark, how are
you? How's it going?
Back for another season.
Back for another season. Yeah, they renewed the contract. They renewed the contract.
I know, I heard it was a little tense.
We had the negotiations were very tense.
Long negotiation there.
All right, we've got no score at the end of one quarter, and decision time for AB on the 8-yard line. That could have easily been a touchdown, but I think Jack was distracted there by the fact that the ball had kind of gone through the fingers or by the fingers of Matt Carter, I believe. But so far, Tim, I like what I see for the first quarter of the first game. You know, they're gonna be nerves, there are gonna be mistakes, but just in terms of the discipline and the structure, I can see it coming together. And the interesting thing this season that I wasn't expecting is so many players appear to be in the mix.
Yeah.
So there's a lot of depth that Coach Maver is using.
More than I can remember. I agree with that. And it's also nice that it seems like we're handling the speed of Cambridge so far very well, and we can run against them. It seems like our offensive line is in control of the game. We just got to put, a good solid drive together. All right.
Yeah, we lost about 1,300 pounds of beef on the O-line to graduation. All right, here it is.
Fourth down on the 8, fourth and goal. Arnold back, he throws it out to Tejeda. He gets a little bit of room, and he's pounding up, but he's going to be stopped.
That's about the 4. And he be a stop after a gain of four. It'll be a turnover.
Okay, Cambridge takes over.
They get the ball back on the 5-yard line. First and 10, Falcons.
Yeah, really, that was his only play at that point. I think that was meant for to hit it right from the start. I think it might have been just telegraphed a little bit.
Well, it's interesting, you know, Mark, the way we have to play football, AB, we don't put ourselves in that position very often. It's very methodical drives, you know, with situations that we're familiar with that we can call out of the playbook and so on. That's a tough red zone play to execute. All right. It's a keeper, or is it?
McMillan on the keeper.
I thought he was just busting through the pack there, but he got stopped short. That's about a gain of 3 yards.
Bring up about second and eight, maybe second and seven. The ball is on the 7-yard line. It's kind of tough to see from this angle.
Now you got to watch out for number 19, Elijah Booker. In the first game, McMillan hit him on a long post pattern, about a 40-yard pass. Booker was about 5 yards behind the nearest defender. There's that bubble
screen. And a missed tackle, and this time he's still going, scrambling around, but stopped at about the 8-yard line, short of the first down.
Well, the missed tackle actually served a purpose of slowing him down, and you can afford to miss a tackle every now and then if you're swarming and gang tackling, and if that missed tackle will stop his forward momentum, and that's exactly what happened. So they're in a tough third down position here, backed up inside their 10-yard line.
Third and eight.
And this is where they may take a shot at Booker, number 19.
Where is Booker?
Booker?
All right, McMillan in the shotgun, goes back. He's looking to pass, looking right, throws the ball deep. And, oh,
and it's
Tejeda.
Intercepted by Tejeda.
Okay, that was Booker. That's what they're exactly what they were trying to do. They were trying to go to Booker, but that pass was beautifully defended. Tejeda had perfect position, and now it's fourth down.
And not a very accurate throw there yet, so here we go.
Well, they realize they're not playing Greater Lawrence Tech tonight.
Right.
They're playing Acton Boxborough. There's a difference.
JT Kelly and Dylan Caldwell back deep for the Colonials. And kick off to the sideline.
Let it go. It goes
across the 40 to about the 42-yard line, first and 10 for the Colonials.
All right, that's great field position again. We got a short field, and this time we do have to take advantage of it and get in for 7 points here. Well, if this were a soccer game, I would say that Acton Boxborough was playing a lot of offense on the other side of the field here.
Football, man.
Football, that's right. Football, European football. Our stat man is Will Henry. He is keeping stats for us tonight. We'll have him for you before the third quarter.
Absolutely. Trips left. And the give is to Gabe Cormier as he's stacked up. But not willing to go down, he pounds up for about 3 tough yards.
And I love that Blade Dudziak was kind of pushing him along, trying to get that extra half a yard.
Perfectly legal in football and
rugby. Oh, absolutely.
All right, second and about 7.
Ethan Jones is doing a nice job. Chris Kokonos is doing a nice job. They're really firing out.
From
here in motion. The toss to Tejeda. He's on the outside, and he pounds up across the 35 to about the 34-yard line. It'll bring up third and about 3.5.
Yeah, that play was designed for Perk to lead him and get a lead block on that, but he just didn't quite get out there. And so Tejeda just went right to the edge and got as much as he could, and it's third and fairly short.
Third and three on the 34.
Two down territory again here, I would say.
Right up the middle, Timmy, right up the middle.
I would say there you go, Cormier. Slicing and dicing, and there he goes, first down.
All right.
Good vision.
We got a Cambridge player down a little bit. He's up now. You know, once again, it's hard to read these numbers with these uniforms. I don't know if it's just old age or whatever, but these uniforms, the Cambridge uniforms, are not conducive to getting those numbers right.
I agree. When they have shadow lettering,
right.
Like that,
no,
I have
no,
problems.
It's not good. It's not good. I need a magnifying glass.
And there it is, a fly with Tejeda as he pounds up and gets about 3 or 4 yards. It was well defended.
Okay, Saponaro, with a lead block, was claiming that there was a face mask on Cambridge. The refs did not agree with him, and it's second down and about 6.
I noticed in warm-ups, Mark, that the reverse off that fly is so wide open against this Cambridge team.
Well, that's what we're talking about, the over-pursuit, and you'll see that at some point in the game. I think it's going to go for a lot of yardage.
Look at the gain there. It's almost 5 yards. It'd be 2nd and 6. Tejeda on the outside. He's got a seam.
Yeah.
He cuts up. A little stiff arm. And it's a first down as he crosses the 20. And close to the 15-yard line.
Tim, that is a captain's play. Barry Wolfson with that block. That absolutely freed Tejeda, opened up a hole to get him that first down yardage. Barry Wolfson, co-captain, along with Hunter Arnold.
That was good play, you know? That's good old Acton-Boxborough football
there. That was really great. That was a great play. And of course, Tom Sapp is our third co-captain this year.
First and 10 on the 17. Here it is, it's the reverse there, and up on his feet again goes Tom Saponaro.
Yes!
He goes in, it's six.
That's the counter. That's the counter, and they ran it to perfection.
I think he was surprised that no one was around him.
Exactly, I mean, he was free there, and then he just kind of got free of his tackler, and another strong run by Sapp.
That was probably one of the most open counters I've seen in a long time.
I want you to look at this counter compared to last year or the year before and how quickly it develops, how quickly Sapp got into the secondary compared to the really slow developing counters of last year and the year before. It could be that you just need a little more, flexible linemen.
Good point. The kick is up by Gabe Cormier, and it is good.
That might be offside against Cambridge. Let's check it out.
It looked like it was, but I didn't see any flags on the field. Oh, there is a flag.
Yeah.
Second quarter, but there is a flag.
I think the guy on the edge tried to.
And it is against Cambridge, and the Colonials will decline.
Yeah, he tried to get that block on that PAT.
I'm always surprised when these great high school athletes, when they jump off, how fast they get back. It would take me. I'd have to make a reservation to get back to my original position, you know. But they just, it's just lightning quick.
I know, great athletes
out there.
Well, they practice that. There's an agility drill for that. It's the old cone drill.
They skip me for that
Right,
one.
Right, you know? Yeah. I gave that up a couple of years ago. Okay, Will Henry, stat man, has given us an update on Thomas Saponaro. 3 carries, 40 yards, one touchdown. That would be 13.3 yards per carry. I brought my calculator with me here.
He's ahead of Shane Vereen already for the season.
And I think he's one fumble short of Steve Ridley, though. So let's keep him there.
All right, Gabe Cormier ready to kick off.
That's right. He did recover that fumble.
Alex Domond is back deep, along with Shaquille Anderson, and they kick it to the sideline there, just nice and cut. Oh, it does a reverse bounce, a retro bounce.
Tough kick.
Out of bounds, that'll be a flag on the play as the kickoff goes out of bounds.
So what, are they going to take it over in their 40? Is it the 40-yard line? Should know our rules better. Let's see what they're talking about. Whatever it is, they're going to take the penalty or the play or whatever. They're not going to re-kick,
okay,
for sure.
Get the ball, first and 10 on the 44.
On the 44. Okay, so they took it where it went out of bounds. All right, short field for Cambridge. Let's see if they can counter. The football is a game of adjustments, and they just haven't been doing what's been advertised and what was scouted.
Shaquille Anderson now in the backfield with McMillan. That's the 1-2 punch right there. And they run it, quarterback keeper, and well defended, but oh, what the speed. As Hunter Arnold pushes McMillon out of bounds after about a 6 or 7 yard run.
Okay, but you can see the speed of McMillon and the speed of Anderson following him. Hunter Arnold made himself known to the whole Cambridge bench then.
That push was perfectly legal. It was in bounds when he pushed him, but.
All right, you're going to be looking at some different schemes here, because what they've been doing hasn't been working so far.
Again, McMillan and Anderson in the backfield.
Yep.
They're going to give to the wide side of the field, trying to leverage that speed, and this time the Colonials cover for about a 2 yard loss.
And that was beautiful because they did exactly what they were supposed to do. Matt Carter, Kyle Anestis, Hunter Arnold, and I think it was Jack Hoggard. He stayed put. And the thing is that you cannot over pursue when they're running the read option and you're guessing. That's when you get into trouble. You have to read that play on defense as they read it on offense.
All right, I bring up third and 7, I'd say, maybe 6. Trips left. Back to passes, McMillan, now a keeper up the middle, and he's caught.
All right.
For another 2 yard loss, it'll bring up fourth down.
Initial pressure was put on by Sapinaro that forced him to the middle, and that's when everybody converged on McMillan, and now it's a punting situation for Cambridge. I believe their punter is Velez, number 6.
It looks, that's, his, looks
his
right.
First punt was a beauty. Good hang time. JT Kelly looking to the right
bad
part
snap,
of the field.
But he gets the ball off very quickly.
Whoa, what a great punt again.
He just flipped it with his ankle, it seems like. We get a run back here. Out of the sidelines, a little break. He cuts back and stumbles to the 40-yard line.
My goodness. That is the return.
JT Kelly.
That is like Billy Jackman-like for sure. And he was so upset when he was tackled. He banged his fist on the ground and said, I could have.
J. Kelly on the run.
JT Kelly is an exciting football player. Boy, Velez, I didn't think he'd get anything on that punt the way he bobbled the ball. That was a beautiful punt.
That's a strong foot. All right, we fake the fly to give it to Cormier up the middle. and about 8 yards.
Well, that's good. Taking a little bit out of Cambridge's playbook there. But you got to give credit to the line.
That'll bring up second and two on the 47 for the
Cardinals. You've got all these kids now going in their senior year that had a place last year that are going to shine this year. And I think 56, Chris Kalkanos is one of them.
Little arch play. Nope, it's a give up the middle to Tejeda as he pounds up for a first down across midfield to the 45.
And you could see that Tejeda was hanging on to that football like it was his grandson, because that ball was, they're definitely trying to strip that ball.
Yeah, definitely. This is coaching technique to go for that ball, turnovers.
But if you don't get the fumble, lots of times you don't get the tackle, and that runner gets 4 or 5 more yards.
Yeah, tight end move there. Yeah,
fake blitz.
There it is, Tejeda. He's got room. He's got a first down run again. Here's, depending on where they spot it, very close.
That'll be a first down.
This looks like Acton Boxborough football, and this is exactly what we talked about them having to do. Is really keep the clock going, keep time of possession, and they're doing a beautiful job of it.
3:27 left to go in the first half.
The Tejeda and Sapanaro have to be approaching about 100 yards total. What do we have for Tejeda
Cambridge
so far?
Tejeda, 13 attempts with 56 yards to show, one fumble.
Okay, 56 yards for Tejeda, 40 yards for Sapanaro, and
33 for Fournier.
Okay, and Cormier has 33 yards, so a good rushing attack so far. You know, Tim, I was wondering the last time if we'd ever played Cambridge before, because certainly in my experience we had. And when we spoke with Coach Gallant, he reminded us that Ed Leary, legendary Acton Boxborough coach, there's a field named after him in Acton, played at Cambridge. He went to high school in Cambridge, and Ray was telling us about the 1977 game where AB beat Cambridge 18-6. And one of our coaches, John Bugsy Flannery, played on that 77 team.
Well, how about that?
Yeah. He played Cambridge for a few years back then.
Bugsy's a pretty good athlete. All right, first and 10. Give us the Cormier up the middle. This time he stopped. Maybe a yard gain.
Short gain on the run. I'll bring up second and 9. On the 34.
Okay, they're a little confused here. A little confused defensively. Number 88 didn't know it was going to be in the game.
And he wasn't even lined up. Tejeda runs right in the slot. He's got an opening. He's going to go down. Wow, out of bounds at about the 15. He was right. They ran right at that gap.
That's exactly right. That's number 88, Miguel. 88, we don't have an 88, actually.
That'll bring up first and 10 on the 15.
First and 10 on the 15-yard line as the Colonials, with 2:39 to go in the first half, are threatening. Cormier up the middle, pounds for about 5 yards.
Run. There's nothing wrong with that run. That takes a lot out of the defense, and that's a great gain on first down. In the red zone.
Second and
5. They're playing a little hurry up here.
Tejeda up the slot.
He's
and
got a
first down.
I think,
hot on the run. Gain of 4 on the carry.
I wouldn't be surprised to see Cambridge call a timeout here. AB is in a hurry up situation. Let's see what happens.
About to timeout.
First and goal for the Colonials.
Timeout Cambridge,
helping us out there.
Yeah.
Timeout Cambridge.
They're definitely back on their heels. They didn't know what to do.
That was interesting. Even early on, Mark, in the first quarter, you could see some of the linemen, defensive linemen of the Falcons, with their hands on their hips and so on, which is, you know, just unusual that early in the game for them to usually a sign they're getting a little tired.
I think what you might have with Cambridge is some tremendous skill players. without tremendous depth and without great linemen. Mm-hmm. Because I read one article where Coach Saulnier, the new coach of Cambridge, it's his first year as head coach of Cambridge, was talking about actually walking in the halls of the school, talking to kids to see if they would come out, you know, big kids, to see if they would come out to be linemen. So, might have a few of those playing right now.
All right, first and goal. Zappanero in motion to give us to Tejeda up the slot again, and he's got a touchdown, untouched. That's an untouched touchdown.
I like it. But, you know, the great thing is that Hunter Arnold, there was a great run by Tejeda, a great hole open by the left side of the line. But you've got Hunter Arnold playing through the fake, playing that pass fake, maybe freezing somebody, and that's what you got to do. He's a great ball handler, and everyone made that look easy.
They really did, and we have run, you know, really just our core set of the playbook, you know, so far in this game. Nothing extraordinary here, and it's working. Our basic execution. All right, with 2:06 to go in the first half, the Colonials line up for the extra point.
I think I've seen this formation since the beginning of time. Oh, once again, that's another flag. It should be.
And the kick is up, and it is good.
And the extra point is good.
This is deja vu all over again here. Offside Cambridge.
So the Colonials go up 14-0 with 2:06 to go in the first half.
The flag with the penalty will be declined.
Everything's going well, except the pizza's getting a little cold, Mark. Other than that, we're in good shape.
Well, you know,
to go the second quarter.
Acton, AB has cooperated. I mean, they've been running the clock as fast as they can, so that's okay. Cold pizza, nothing wrong with cold pizza.
Nope. Cold fusion, cold pizza, it's all good.
Well, we really, really haven't put the ball in the air, hardly at all. It's just been the running attack. If it works, keep doing it. And certainly our line has been dominant so far.
Well, why do it when you have all that speed back there? You know, the cornerbacks of the Cambridge are really good athletes, so.
Right, exactly. Exactly. Know. We've got 17 yards passing so far for the first half.
We're working into an excellent, you know, we're working into some excellent play action opportunities when it lines up right. We get a second and two. And there'll be a play action opportunity that's significant.
And Alex Dumont.
Especially as we're in Falcon territory. So Gabe Cormier looking to kick and back deep.
Okay, we got Anderson and Dumont back deep.
They kick another blooper, so this time it's caught.
Whoa! Oh,
and it might be. Wow!
There's a flag there. Now, I don't know if
that a headshot?
It could be a headshot, or he might have called for a fair catch. He might have put his hand up for a fair catch.
I think
it's more of a headshot issue, and they're really clamping down on that. And they can actually suspend a player for the rest of the game right on the spot. So the refs are conferring right now to decide what to do on this.
I think it was number 81, Muhammad Udin, I believe, and you can see the coach saying to him on the way off the sideline, you know, put your hand up for to call for a fair catch. So I think that's it. I hope
it's a fair catch violation here.
I'm going to say it's a personal foul, but.
Oh, okay, offsetting personal fouls.
Wow.
No harm, no foul.
What was the other personal foul? I don't know what happened there.
That is about the last thing that I expected was offsetting personal fouls.
That's true.
Penalties on both teams, so they'll be offset.
Somebody must have.
And the Colonials will re-kick.
You know, responded to that, which, you know, I can understand. You know, that kind of thing.
Now, they have offsetting personal fouls that appeared to be after the play, but yet they're re-kicking. So those personal fouls must have taken place during the play and not after the play.
Wow. That's
the only reason that they would re-kick.
Well, that's excellent research by you. You catch that. Again, some confusion on behalf of the Falcons because they're not even lined up right for the kick yet.
Now Cormier clearly doesn't want to kick deep to Anderson, to number one, but I think he wants to maybe squib it a little bit. He's been hooking this. Timeout AB.
Yep.
Now Cormier's been like a golfer who's been hooking his 9-iron, and that ball has been going about to 40-yard line. Well, Chris Noeth is in there, number 16. He's changed his number. It's hard to see number 16 and not say Joe Yulee. Joe had a really, really good career with AB.
He sure did. All right. The dangerous Anderson and DeMond back deep. And let's see what Gabe Cormier has in store this time. Down the middle.
That's a squib. That's
right. And a good hop in the back. And all right.
I still got great field position though at about the 43-yard line, so we've got to defend with 1:57 to go in the half.
Down at the 42, and that's where the Falcons will pick it up.
Now, Tim, have they run a fly yet? They've maybe won one fly so far.
I think so. Maybe one. I don't even remember the one they ran, but. Now there's
that big,
great play.
That is, yeah. That's
wow,
their toughest
number 34,
runner. That is Sebastian
Robert.
Yeah.
And that's their back in the in the scouting report. That's their.
Right. That's the guy who will run over guys.
Now where was that for the last, two quarters? First and 10, Falcons, and they do the same play again as he cuts up the middle. And Gabe Cormier with the tackle as they adjust. That's about another 4 yards. Clock running.
We're seeing Kyle Anestis all over the field. Kyle's having a really good game.
Taking a lot of time between plays. 1:21 and counting.
Oh!
In and out of the hands.
And the pass is dropped.
Well, I'll tell you, that's a break because that was the best pass that McMillan has thrown tonight. And that was right between the 1 and the 9 of Elijah Booker, and he just dropped it.
Intended for number 19, Elijah Booker.
Not much else you can say about that. That was just a drop, and it's about 3rd and 7 right now from the 37.
1:13 to go. Trips left. Whoa, what a catch. And out of bounds, I believe.
No, they didn't call him out of bounds. They gave it to him. And Booker has made up for the last play with a nice catch and a nice run after catch.
And a good throw. That was a good play all the way around.
All the way down to the 15-yard line with 1:03 to go. So Cambridge is picking up a little life here at the end of the first half.
Much better execution by Cambridge. Looked like a different team. Looks like we just had Whalen come on the field. Much better. Sebastian Robert, the running back. McMillan with the fake, and now the keeper up the slot. And he pounds
and
up for
yep.
Touchdown.
Falcons for a touchdown.
Well, that took exactly 1 minute and 1 second to go the length of the field from the 43-yard line. So Cambridge is not lying down here.
Completely different look. Execution-wise.
Now, Coach Gallant believes that there's a flaw in the Cambridge blocking scheme on points after, and he has predicted a block tonight. So we'll see. It's on the right-hand side. Looks like they probably corrected that, though. Oh, it's blocked. It's blocked.
No good.
Well, I tell you, he's Nostradamus, right?
Well, why didn't you just keep that? You could have just.
I could have taken credit for
you
that.
You could have taken credit for that. But you're a good man.
No, I got to give credit where credit's due. That could be a big. You know, that once again, when that kick gets blocked and there's an 8-point lead rather than a 7-point lead, that is big. Well, there's 56 seconds, Tim. Let's see what happens.
Well, we're going to have to adjust to that new look in their offense. That's a lot better. You know.
Well, I was really surprised that they were not using Johnson at the beginning of the game. I mean, they had Kozlowski in, who really is a defensive player. I don't know what he was doing in the backfield. You know, perhaps there was some kind of disciplinary action.
It could be.
Something you just don't know. But Johnson.
It looks like something Bill Belichick would do.
Yeah, Johnson is a north-south runner with the ability to bounce it out with his speed.
Oh, 56 seconds. I think we've used just one timeout in the first half.
Okay, we got two burners back there in Tejeda and JT Kelly.
And Booker getting set to kick off. And he kicks a squib down the middle. JT Kelly grabs it, and he gets tripped up at the 20.
Well, he's down at the 20-yard line.
It's Najon Dillon, a senior linebacker. Actually, we don't really know what they are, because when we get rosters now, this is like the Cold War. Rosters don't tell you anything. They tell you the kid's name and his year. No height, no weight, no position. Nobody wants to give any information anymore. This could be the boys' soccer team for all I know. All right, let's see what we do here from our 20. Timeout, Falcons. They're having a little internal disagreements there on the sideline.
Definitely a little disorganized on the Falcons side. New coaching staff, et cetera. First and 10. A good seam route by Gabe Cormier as he bounces off and gets about 5 or 6 yards. 43 okay. Seconds and counting in the first half.
No timeouts.
And a game of five on the play.
No timeouts from AB. They're taking their time.
Five on the 25 for the
Looks like they're just going to run it out here.
30 seconds left to go in the half.
Tejeda.
Just hang on
to
the ball.
Holding down that football.
He's holding that ball.
Gets a first down.
That's going to stop the clock with 19 seconds to go. I don't see anything but another handoff here. I don't think we're going to do anything fancy.
Tejeda on the outside. And he gets enough running room to go for another first down. And there's
and
no time left, and that'll be the half, folks.
And that will be a first down.
Okay, he's
and
just
that's the end of
he's
the
just
half,
padding
folks.
His stats right now.
So, Mark, you know, first half of the season, and, you know, I think the story is we settled down after the first 5 or 6 minutes. You know, as we started to play more mistake-free football and the blocking scheme got underway and we got a feel and got comfortable tonight, it's been Colonial football all the way. Looks
yeah,
good.
I think the offense looks real good. I'm concerned about giving Cambridge any hope. Which they got at the end of the first half, doing things a little bit different. You saw the athleticism of McMillan on that touchdown run. They can break it at any time. So once again, that extra point block could loom big in a close game.
Yeah, but, those last 2 minutes from Cambridge is just enough to make
just
us
enough, right? Just enough to make you a little tingly. Yes, yeah.
So with that, we'll see you on the other side of the half, folks.
Adams. Here. Michael Adams. Here. Michael Adams.
Here!
Michael Adams.
Students who miss 18 days of school in any grade risk falling behind and not graduating. Absences add up. Keep track at boostattendance.org today.
All right, welcome back, everybody. It's time for our Statman Halftime Highlights, brought to you by the law firm Shire, Caton, and Epstein. Mark, what do you have?
Okay, Will Henry, our Statman, our superhero, has been busy calculating all the plays here. And we've got rushing Will Tejeda, 18 rushes for 98 yards, almost 5 yards a clip. And Tom Sapanaro is 3 rushes for 40 yards. And Gabe Cormier, 9 rushes for 44 yards. And through the air, Hunter Arnold has really kept to the ground game. He's 2 for 3 for 17 yards. Both passes completed to Will. And that does it for the first half stats. And we've done, I think, what we want to do, which is really kind of keep the ball on the ground, run the clock, and keep time of possession.
That's perfect, Mark. Again, you know, it's a great stat review. We're happy to have Will. Thank you very much, Will, for all the calculating and, you know, the abacus you have and the big data processor and all that other stuff. Will, we appreciate that very much. And it's perfect timing because we're ready for the second half here as the Colonials get set to kick off here. And we got a fresh clock. It's 14-6 Colonials. It's been an up and down. It was an up and down first quarter, Mark, but everything started to settle down and the Colonials started to roll. But yeah, there was a little threat of Falcon speed at the end of that first half. So here we go.
That's called a speed bump, Tim. And once again, you know, we say this about once every other game, that the first possession of the second half is just so crucial. And I think in this game it's even more important because Cambridge just came off a touchdown, and let's see what happens here.
And this time they kick it away to the speed of the Falcons. And there we go, up the middle and well covered to the 35-yard line. So a much better situation for AB as we gain about 10 yards in that strategy based on what we were giving up in the first half.
Yeah, and you saw our sophomore there, number 23, Kyle Tobin, a really solid kid. And Coach Gallant is really high on Kyle Tobin. Number 23, watch him. He'll be getting more and more time. Will, our stat man, says we have 194 yards rushing in the first half.
That is impressive, on our way to a 400-yard offensive attack. All right, look at that. You know, Roberts is not in the backfield, interesting, but they do a read option this time.
Oh yeah, Jack Hoggard, right on, great read by Jack. And he was right on top of him. Wouldn't even let him get started.
Bring up second 11.
That's the kind of linebacker play we're looking for. Just seemed like every time Jack got into a game last year, we were calling his number.
I'm looking, here's Robert. Robert's on the sideline. Robert on the sideline there behind the coach. So this is really interesting.
Yeah, just wondering what's going on with him because he was really the most effective.
I'll certainly buy him dinner if he stays right there.
Yeah, that's fine with me. Got Matt Carter moving in the secondary there.
This time
they
fake the fly and up the middle with a big time run goes McMillan as he scrambles close to a first down.
He was really fighting for it. He's about a yard short, right at the 45-yard line, 46.
Forward progress mark there, Mark, and it is a first down to the
46. Really, they gave him a great spot. Well, he earned that. And they've got to stop that right. You know, what he'll do is he'll take a step back, go right up the middle. And that's been their most effective play so far.
Well, this coach is building a lot of drama. They're faking flies, but they're not running. And there it is, the read option. It's a little quick out and about a 6 or 7 yard gain.
It looks like Cambridge is, you know, is continuing. They developed some rhythm that last offensive series of the first half, and they're just continuing that right here, and they're in AB territory.
Bring up second and five as they cross midfield.
Oh, there. Oh, I tell you, I thought that was movement there.
There's the read option with Anderson, nice. And nothing there, very quick.
All right.
You know what's great to see, Mark, on our defense, for the first time in a while, and I missed it dearly, is we're running a five with plunkers.
Yeah, exactly.
We know how to run that kind of defense, and it's just refreshing to see much quicker reaction on the outside with that multi-pronged, you know, kind of decision live linebacker on the line of scrimmage approach. It's just great to see. You can see it having an impact in this game.
Absolutely. You've got Nick Moore, number 52, at nose tackle there.
All right, about a yard lost there, so it's third and six.
You're like a shotgun almost here.
Yeah, empty set. McMillan back to pass, and it's complete. And all the way, look at the speed there. It's down to the 10-yard line. Goes.
That's Velez.
Yeah. Wow. You get him in the open field, and he's off to the races.
For a 40-yard gain.
And that's all you have to do is you have to get these guys in space. They make one man miss, and they're off to the races. So Cambridge looking to either get within one or equalize this game right now. They're knocking on the door at the 10.
All right, it's opportunity for an interception here. First and 10. Take them right down to the goal line. So it's on the ball's on the 10-yard line and nothing
that
there.
That was a busted play. I think that was a handoff to Booker, and Booker just went by too quick because he was looking to hand off to Booker there. And he had no place to go with it.
They send Kozlowski in with the play. Actually, they send him in and then they give the play to McMillan. Second and 11, there's a little slant pattern and it's incomplete.
And McMillan's pass is incomplete.
And you wonder why they're running that. Maybe they're setting up the corner route, Mark, but it just, with this speed, he fakes it in and goes to the corner and just lobs it up there. And it's a tough play for us to make. So
yeah,
I don't understand.
You've got a guy like Booker with great speed and good height. But frankly, I don't know why they're just sitting back and throwing the ball. I don't think they're playing to their strength at this point.
All right, third and 13. They're bringing them right to the 1 yard line.
Let's see if we blitz on this play here.
They run an arch and a slant opportunity again. Almost.
Oh, we got a flag.
Wow.
There is a flag. Oh.
I didn't see that.
I think it's against Cambridge.
And no flag.
That's right. I didn't see the ball was tipped. That's exactly what I was going to say. I really didn't see that there would be a flag on that play with a tipped ball, and they picked up that flag. That's a big break here.
So I'm going to predict now they run that corner route in the lob. I think McMillan can make that throw.
You got to look at a fade to Booker. Big play. Huge play right now. You got DeMond on the right and Velez on the left.
And look for Anderson. He's in the slot. And it's pressure, and then he's loose. McMillan's loose. And that may be the best thing that happened to us.
Oh my God! That's a touchdown! Oh my God, Velez off the deflection picks it up.
Alex Dumond.
And I'm sorry, that is number three, Alex Dumond. We had that perfectly defended. And that ball was a wounded duck.
That is just a play that, you know. On the 10, you run a Hail Mary from the 10-yard line and it pays off.
Wow. Got to figure they're going for two now to tie it up. And we got a ball game here, Tim.
These Division I games aren't going to be easy, Mark. Big play here. McMillan goes in the huddle. Kozlowski has the single back. McMillan looking right. He's looking for that corner route. And it's intercepted.
We got a flag on the play here. Let's see what the flag is.
There is a flag on the play.
It's either offensive or defensive holding, I think. Nope. That's it.
Did they pick it
no
up?
No good. No good. No, it was illegal procedure against Cambridge, so it's 14 to 12.
14 to 12 was 7:01 to go in the third quarter. And wow.
Well, sometimes you just get lucky. We had that play perfectly defended. We had two defenders there in that pass, and I don't know. I'd like to see the replay on that and wanted to see if one of the Falcons made kind of a basketball play on it and just kind of tapped it to his teammate, or whether it was a straight deflection.
All right, an early season test for the Colonials now. It's time to respond and get some clock churned up and a score. There's nothing that, you know, in the first half that really shouldn't give us a lot of confidence in our ability to drive down the field against these Falcons from an offensive point of view.
Well, the key here is simply to respond, to work the clock, and to just keep doing what you've been doing successfully. Our O-line has shown that they can control the line of scrimmage. And you got all that rushing yardage in the first half. That tells you something.
Dylan Caldwell and Will Tejeda back deep for the Colonials. They kick it down the middle. It's Gabe Cormier. Did she pick it up? Nope. Who wants that ball? Wow, a big hard hit.
Yeah, that was Kyle Torben picking the ball up and carrying it out to about the 29-yard line.
And he got hit pretty hard there.
Kyle Torben on the return.
Yeah, that was a tough kickoff. That ball was really bouncing along. Tobin did a good job just to pick it up and gain a few positive yards.
First and 10 Colonials, the ball's on the 29.
Well, you go play action, about the last thing they would expect.
Tejeda cuts across and gets caught up at the 32, and he would have been at midfield.
You could see Tejeda's eyes. Oh, that ankle, it could be they got his ankle. Oh, that's a big blow. That's a big blow if he can't go. Let's hope it may be a cramp.
Yeah, a shoestring tackle on a bad ankle is about it.
Yeah,
know,
that's
the worst
about
thing.
As bad as it gets. He looked like he was just about full speed this whole game. And
although Mr. C, the way he's working on it, looks like a cramp.
Yeah.
The magic of Mr. C. I mean, you know, this, you know, I think for his second career, he should, you know, he could be a healing man, you know.
Let's see, that is certainly
a cramp.
A cramp. Yeah. That's great news. Great news.
Look at Mr. C go to work.
He's a master, isn't he?
Look at that.
He's a master. You know, you should put a number on his back.
I think
you
know,
right. Like a C, like for captain.
I think you have to address him correctly. It's Mr. C.
Mr. C.
Watch this. Watch him rise up
there
now.
There we go.
Okay. There you go.
He's up. He's walking.
The only reason he's going off because he has to go off for one play. Mr. C, you know, it's all fixed.
Well, Will Tejeda's eyes were on the goalpost.
Yeah,
he was looking to move it upfield and just got picked up. He's over 100 yards now for the game.
All right, that'll bring up, let me get my bearing here, 2nd and 8. Double wing. Up the middle goes Cormier, patiently cutting up for about 3 or 4 patient yards. And that bring up 3rd and 5.
Yeah, this is a really important down.
3-3 on
the carry. We've got to keep our defense off the field.
3rd and 5.
Cambridge moved the ball all the way down. And we've really got to pick up this first down.
And Sapinero was leaving the huddle, but now he comes back. I would say that we want Tom on this in this down for sure.
Yeah, I'd like this ball to go to Sap right now.
He is the three back in this configuration, wing right. And it is to Sap on a Delaware, and he gets caught. He's scrambling, very close.
He's all about a yard short. That was great pursuit on behalf of Cambridge there, and that's going
to
bring
wide
up
on
a
speed.
Fourth down.
Yep. Not fooled on that Delaware, really. Cambridge had a good flow to that ball. And I think we're going for it.
Okay, here it is, mano a mano.
4th and 1.
4th and 1.
Do we line up on flex?
4th and 1 on the 38.
How do we line up here? Let's see, we got a flex formation. I think we do. Flex, no splits on that offensive line.
Eight in
up the middle.
Yes, right through.
We push him back.
Oh, look at
yards.
That run.
First down.
Oh, my goodness.
What a push.
Oh, Perk, I'll tell you. Perk just moved two guys out of the way there. Barry Wolfson, unbelievable. That was when they had to push, they pushed.
Well, I think we might want to run flex.
Now, I hope this is another cramp here. Here's Mr. C coming out. He's a busy man tonight. I think he's going to do his cramp stretch again.
Who is that, Mark?
Is that Gabe?
Might be Gabe. I can see the 3.
I think it's Gabe. And I think it's a cramp once again. There we go. Okay.
Look at Mr. C do that.
Look at that technique.
Oh.
It's amazing.
You know, I think Mr. C, that needs to be on the cover of next year's program.
No, it actually needs to be on the cover of Sports Illustrated. That's where I'd like to see it. He has been a constant. I would tell you, he took care of our sons
pretty well.
And I know that there were 4 or 5 situations where he was really instrumental in my son's career.
I think he took care of my grandfather.
Okay, Gabe running off the field. Looks pretty good. And we've got a first down here. Got a little momentum. We got to get that mo going here.
1st and 10 on the 43 for the Colonials.
Got a lot of guys in the box here. There's a play action. That's what we're talking about. Oh!
Hey, looks like interference. There's no backturn there on that ball.
I will disagree with you. I think that was a great defensive play, and that pass came so close to being completed to Sapinaro. I thought he was going to connect with him, but I like the play call. Because they're putting 7, 8 guys in the box right now, and you got to keep them honest.
Bring up 2nd and 10 on the 43 for the Colonials.
2nd and 10 on the 43-yard line. Up the middle we go, and a good cut, Gabe Cormier.
Oh, yes.
Close to a first down as he pounds up
And that was punishing, and he absolutely punished Marcus Collins, number 12, from Cambridge.
Wow, that was a good run. Great vision by Gabe. He just really keeps his head up, makes a very efficient set of cuts.
And he was the aggressor on that one.
I'd line up flex right here.
That is the longest run of the half so far.
Up the middle again. We go for about three tough yards.
This is responding. Kyle Once again, it's the line.
Kyle Tobin, I believe, on that run.
Yep.
For the Colonials.
Kyle, a sophomore.
Yeah, he's very compact, very strong, a very heady player. He's a football player.
First down on the 45 of the Falcons. Little counter. And Sapanero making something out of nothing.
He just wouldn't be denied, would he? I mean, what a great two-yard run. You know, you make positive yardage. That could have been a three-yard loss easily.
Now, if I'm Coach Maver here, I think you pull a change up here, something you haven't run.
I got to open it up here. Got to open it up somehow.
Second and eight. Wow, what a cut. And the forward motion will take it to about the 40. It'll be about third and five.
He is tackled by number 19, Elijah Booker.
Okay, that's going to be four down territory here at the 40-yard line. Any positive yardage on this play, you can be sure they're going to be going for it.
Third and five on the 40.
Third and five on the 40-yard line, 2:59 and counting in the third quarter. High formation for the first time tonight with a slot left. Little vertical seam. Sapanero cuts up. He's going to see me. Pounds up across the 30 to the 28-yard line.
And did you see those knees churning? And once again, this poor Marcus Collins is really, he's getting hit in the chest. He's getting kneed.
And that's the changeup. We want it marked right there. I mean, I wasn't thinking pass. I'm just thinking take a different formation, put a different back in there with some vision, and then we line up again on that eye. One more time.
Oh,
and he's tripped up on a run blitz, and there's a flag.
No gain, lost on the play. Now, and there is a flag.
Wait a minute, Sapp is getting up slowly.
Against AB.
Is that a chop block?
I believe so.
Yeah, a chop block against AB. You don't see that called very often.
Wow.
That's a low block. Blocked by the knees. That's going to be a big mark off against AB. That's one of the
illegal block.
That's a big penalty.
15-yard penalty.
He's just going to keep walking and walking and walking. You know, in high school, when you get a 15-yarder. Oh, did he walk off 15? I'm not sure if he walked off 15 yards.
We'll take that.
I'll be happy with that. Yeah. No, he did. He walked off 15 yards. It's first and 25 here.
First and 25, yeah. Play action, Hunter Arnold. Wide's back, and it's complete. Down, touchdown, Colonial.
Whoa, there's no flag.
Jack Hoggard with a beautiful reception, and what a throw by Hunter Arnold. A little aerial attack by the Colonials.
And Hunter Arnold hit him absolutely in stride. That pass couldn't have been thrown any better. And that was the only place that would allow Jack to be able to keep in stride and get into the end zone. And whoa, quick strike. Love it.
Wow. And that was the response we wanted, Mark. We've chewed up a lot of clock, drove down the field. I think we've expanded our offensive scheme to give the Falcons a little bit more to think about.
Yeah, it was a 44-yard pass. Now, here's the significance of this extra point. This extra point makes this a two-possession game. We'll give AB a 9-point lead, so this is huge. Absolutely
and a nice,
perfect.
Solid yeah. chip shot by good. Dave Cormier.
Well, the score is 21.
And that's the way he kicked it too, like a little chip shot.
There it is. Very nice. 21 to 12. The Colonials with 1:48 to go in the third quarter, and that is the smoothest extra point kick I've seen in a long time.
Yeah, that was just very nice. Very confident, and I'm not sure if he was even aware of how significant that 1 point is, but that's a big eight to 9 points is a huge swing.
Just big time. What a great response by the Colonials in this early season, just to test, you know, what we're made out of here, and the early indication is we're looking good here, Mark.
Okay, momentum has swung here.
Back to receive.
Gabe Cormier ready to kick off to the dangerous Anderson, and it's a squib. And Robert takes it up to about the 37-yard line. There's a lot of big hitting going on out there.
I would really love to know the story of Robert's playing and not playing this game.
Well, he's in there now.
Yeah, I mean, whenever he's in there, things happen. Number four seems to be hurt, Kozlowski, coming off a little bit gingerly.
So send a telegram to Coach Maber that Robert is in the game, and because this ball's going to go to him right now. There's a fake to Robert. It's a little sprint out pass to Anderson as he cuts back against the grain, and well covered by the Colonials.
Wow, he is elusive though, isn't he?
Shaquille Anderson.
Whoa. We have really been able to keep him in check. I hate to even say that because I wound up jinxing the team, but we have kept him in check the whole game. But you can see his elusiveness even on a 2-yard reception. And they're more in a hurry up right now.
Second and 9. Ball on the 37-yard line. Empty backfield. Robert in the slot, and again, it's the pass up, and they go down the sideline. And wow, this is going to be taken to the house.
Touchdown.
A quick strike by the Falcons.
On the touchdown play.
Whoa.
Wow, that's some speed.
That is pure speed. That's not one of the speed guys that we're talking about.
63-yard reception.
Our scouting report says that's good speed.
Yeah, good speed.
I think that's great speed, I'll tell you.
He ran away from everybody. And now we're back to a 3-point game. This is going back and forth right here. Nothing's easy here. Two quick strikes, one by AB, and Cambridge answers right back.
Wow.
Trying to make it a 1-point game here.
McMillan looking, scrambling.
Oh, Nick Moore almost had him.
Overthrown,
and
no good.
Conversion is no good.
Nick Moore put some really good pressure on McMillan and got kind of clipped there right as he was going to hit him, but forced him into that pass. And it's a 3-point game. It's a field goal.
44 seconds to go. Yeah. Boy. I still can't believe the speed.
Oh boy, he was gone. He was absolutely gone. He was just.
He must be on that
track relay team. Kind of reminded me of Secretariat in the Belmont there when he was just expanding that to like 30 lengths.
Wow.
Very entertaining game. First game of the season.
21-18 here. And
It's interesting how the teams are, it's one punch after another using their strengths. You know, with AB with its running attack, a little play action, and Cambridge with its really, it's open field passing attack. You know, you get people in space and let the speed take over. So both teams operating off their strengths. Really no surprises from the scouting report. And it's, you know, which team can defend the offensive attack of the other.
Right, it could come down to the team that has the ball last at this point.
Tejeda and it's short. Up the middle, good, solid, low, efficient run.
I like the way Kyle Tobin runs, very low to the ground, and made some very good positive yardage up to the 45-yard line.
Very, you know, well-coached, mature kid, because he got the most yardage he could possibly get out of that situation.
And protected the ball.
All right, first and 10 from the 45-yard line of the Colonials. Sapinero in the three-back spot. And it's a Delaware from Sapinero. He goes up the seam.
Oh,
and boy, he gets close to a first down. He explodes through that gap.
But he really got hit. I was concerned that that ball was going to be bouncing out. He got hit so hard right on the ball, but held on to it. And it's second and short. And that may be the end of the third quarter. They got about 15 seconds to get this playoff.
There's a player down for the Falcons, number five, which is Captain Sean Phillips. Looks like another cramp, hopefully.
He's a really tough
kid. Actually, looking at his knee.
Yeah. He's one of their top players. He's been a three-way starter for Cambridge. Really tough kid. You know, Tim, I really wonder about the whole etiquette that teams have about when someone is hurt. Some teams will kneel down, some teams won't. And he's coming off on he's jogging off, which is a good sign.
A great sign.
All right, second and short. 9 seconds to go in the third quarter. We're gonna get that playoff.
Cormier bouncing outside down the sideline for about 15 yards.
Okay, that brings us closer as we hit the end of the third quarter in about the 34-yard line. As we switch sides, start the fourth quarter, and we're on the move again, Tim. Well, Tim, you know, this year, most people can see that this is the first year that we've been able to have sponsorships. And the purpose really of the sponsorships are to allow us to bring the truck and have a director, to have four camera people, to try to, you know, try to make the broadcast a little bit better, more pleasing to the eye. Unfortunately, we can't get better announcers because, you know, you just can't do that. There's just so much money in the budget. But I would like to thank our other sponsors tonight. The Steinberg Lally Charitable Foundation, Gallant Insurance, Harsip and Stewart, Family Law Attorneys, Wayside Kitchens,
first quarter.
Bay State Elder Law, Bill Nickerson of Merrimack Mortgage Company, and also Chris Tejeda and Brendan Cotter, who have also contributed, along, of course, with Life Care Center of Acton, our pregame sponsor, and Shire Caton and Epstein, who sponsor Statman this year. And want to thank everybody for helping us all with this football broadcast.
We appreciate it, and the response has been tremendous, and we feel privileged to represent our sponsors. Cormier, up the slot.
Good game, good game.
6 yards, so thank you so much, sponsors, for your support of the program.
And I think you're right, Tim. I think the D line is wearing down. I mean, just take a look at that nose tackle right now. He was on his knees, had his hands on his hips.
Second and four. Tejeda up the slot, following his block. He's out in the gap for about a 15, 20-yard romp.
Just imagine if that kid were playing at 100%.
Yep. Boy, I love that. You just put the hand on the back and follow your blocker and, wow. Okay, first and 10, Colonials. The ball's on the 10, and they go right to the half-inch line on this, so it's not first and goal. Wing right.
20 carries.
Cormier up the slot. He smells goal line, and he is in for
the touchdown. And that was a great, great block. Absolutely great blocking by that whole left-hand side of the line. And really, that does, I mean, on Tejeda's run, I mean, the blocking scheme and the blocking execution was absolutely fantastic. And I want to really single out Ethan Jones. He's had a heck of a game, and they're just really taking control of the line of scrimmage. I think they have a tired D-line, and I think that they're like in mid-season form right now. They're enjoying themselves.
The only problem is we didn't use enough clock there, Mark.
Cormier, six rushes for 40 yards.
Okay, Gabe is six rushes for 40 yards and a touchdown here.
And the kick is up and it is blocked.
And the extra point is no good.
Wow, that throws a little interest more in a game here. So well, 27-18, 9:59 to go in the game.
It does at least keep our 9-point advantage, which makes it a two-possession game, which will get much more important as this clock winds down. We've got 9:59 to go. Well, Tim, you look at the DCL. You know, we do play in the dual county league, so we should talk about it. Waltham is considered one of the teams to beat this year. Westford got crunched by Lowell in their first game. They got shut out 21-0. But Lowell is a really strong Division I team. Westford now is in Division II. Chelmsford got beat 21-6. So a lot of the teams that we're going to be facing had a rough first game. Lincoln Sudbury, of course, won their first game. They've won 11 out of their last 12 games.
And they're not playing in Division I. Go figure.
No, you know. I cannot understand, since they've beaten us, I think, 4 years in a row. And they were 10-1 last year, and they're Division II, we're Division I. But you know, you play the cards that are dealt you, and this could very well mean, if we're in the playoffs, a first round game against Everett. We would never get that.
All right, Gabe Cormier ready to kick, and we have Anderson and DeMond back deep, and it's a squib down the middle. It's caught like a fastball and drop and down at the 39. Boy, that was complicated.
And the ball is down.
Could you repeat that? I didn't catch that.
Sounded like a baseball play or something.
That's where Cambridge offense will pick it up, first and 10.
Okay, now it's time to try to make Cambridge use some clock and just, you know, avoid these quick hits.
Well, you know, I know what Coach Gallant's going to do here. In my opinion, I think we're going to throw a little wrinkle in that secondary and try to go for an interception. This is how we play Waylon about this time of the game. There's an interception that gets taken to the house. So it's
an invert. I will note your order for an interception.
McMillan with a little sprint out. He's in trouble.
Oh,
it's a fumble. Well, there you go. It's a turnover.
Yes,
anyhow.
And that is not a forward pass. That is a fumble.
There's a fumble, and it looks like Acton Boxborough.
All right. Tim, I got so excited with that, I didn't even pick up who recovered the ball.
You know, but it is interesting, in these spread offenses, they are so explosive. But on the other hand, you know, you handle the ball in situations that add risk to the game, so you have the plus and the minus here really requires a very precise
game. Right, and there was indecision on his part. He wanted to throw that ball.
Gabe Kormier up the slot as he pounds, holds on the football, gets a second chance.
Oh, yes.
And gets about 7 or 8 yards on the second effort.
This reminds me of a couple of games we played against Woburn, where over the course of the game, particularly in the second half, we just wore out their D-line and just absolutely took over the line of scrimmage, and that appears to be happening right now.
All right, wing left.
Well, there's
somebody
a
moved,
false start.
And that's going to bring it back.
Flag on the play.
Very costly here. We want to keep the momentum of this drive.
That's going to give us about a second and 7 or so. Just a little more challenging.
So you see number 6.
That's Velez.
You see how fast he is. He's playing outside linebacker corner. You know, the speed they have on the outside of this defense is something else.
Second and 7 on the 30 for the Colonials.
Chapinero in motion. The counter with Kormier up the middle again.
That
he gets
was a
about
great
the same
play
yards.
Call. That was a great play call for that defense at that point. Because the defense at that point was running away from that play up the middle.
Gain of 6 on the carry for Kormier.
Third and short.
3rd and 1.
Kormier is, you can see what a tough runner he is. I mean, you've got guys, you know, Sapinero and Kormier.
It's like we said, you know, last year you could see this talent rising to the top. Kormier was good last year. Little arch motion to give us the Sapinero off the slot as he pounds up for about 6 yards for a first down.
Yeah, I think he took number 5 back in the game. Thomas, he took him for a little ride for a few yards.
Protecting the ball away. He put his back to the player there. Smart move. Don't expose the ball. See if you can get a little bit of yards and a push. First down on the ball is on that, let's see.
18 yard line.
Sapinero at the 3-back spot. Kormier again up the slot. As he cuts up and pounds and spins and second effort.
Oh, I tell you, he was still moving. They called forward progress and he was still churning his legs and making positive yardage there. They didn't trust how good Gabe Kormier is. Yeah, those legs were still moving.
He really doesn't give up at all. He's a very persistent runner. Hunter Arnold taking his time, want to use a little bit of clock. 7:16 to go in the game. 27-18 Colonials.
Well, it's very hard to defend a line that is in great shape, enthusiastic, and tough, along with tough runners.
Tejeda on a slant,
quick hitter. My goodness, that's, talk about changing it up a little bit. That's the first quick hitter we've seen tonight.
And it brings up first and goal and on the 3-yard line.
First down. First and goal on the 3.
.647 and counting. First and goal on the 3. Kormier up the slot again as he bounces off and pounds up for maybe on the 1.
Short gain on the run. He is tackled.
Well, let's check out Will. Well, Will just fell down. He seems to be okay. I don't know if he's limping a little bit or if he's got an ankle problem.
Yep, he shuffled to the sideline.
Yeah, he definitely shuffled. I think that ankle is bothering him.
We have a replacement in for Will.
No, the fact of the matter is, if you score now, maybe you just let him sit. You don't want to hurt. You don't want that ankle to be re-injured.
Kormier up the middle, patiently running.
Oh,
his touchdown.
He's in.
With 5:53 to go.
Right behind his line. Kyle Tobin there.
Touchdown number 32.
Jack Hoggard.
33 points for the Colonials tonight with 5:53 to go in a game. And a multi-pronged running attack
You know, this front line, I'm going to call them the 50s. You know, you got 53 Ethan Jones, you got 54 Perk. We're going to call them the 50s, the big 50s. I remember the 50s. That was a great decade.
I had a short stint in the 50s. But I did have a little bit of me.
The 50s are playing awesome tonight.
That's a great nickname.
Okay, Gabe Cormier, 108 yards rushing, two touchdowns. That puts two over 100 yards for the game.
A swinging gate there. Kick is down, the kick is up, and it is good.
And the extra point is good.
With 5:53 to go in the game, it's the Colonials 34 and the Falcons 18.
With 5:53 left in the fourth quarter, Colonials 34, Falcons 18.
And that kicker was number one, Liam Ben-Joseph, who is had his first varsity action. He came from the boys' soccer team. And this is his first year of football, and he's a kicker, and he just kicked one.
We bring our towel from all sorts of places.
And he's going to be kicking off, too. Yeah, he's probably going to, like, fly right from this game right to, like, the World Cup qualifier or something. I think he played against Mexico this week. Let's see what kind of foot he has here. 34-18, 5:53 to go.
Now, you know, we're not safe yet with this explosive
offense.
Not at all. That's
two,
for sure.
Two scores and two point afters, that's a tie game.
And they can score in a minute or less. This very explosive team. Good squib down the middle, caught. And
oh,
well,
great
covered.
Pursuit. Great pursuit. Tobin, you're going to hear
and
that name
down,
quite a bit.
39. And that's where the Falcons offense will pick it up. First and 10 on the 39.
And Nick Klubot was there too. Nick, a really good special teams player. Okay, don't give up the big ones here. Make them earn it if they're going down the field.
First and 10 from the 39. McMillan, back to pass, throws the ball deep. He's got Velez all alone, but overthrew him.
Yeah, Velez was 5 yards behind Jonathan Mandel on that play.
Deshaun Velez.
Just crazy speed. I mean, these guys have crazy speed.
Second and 10 on the 39.
And Tim, the one thing that you pointed out, I think, right from the beginning is the lack of cohesiveness, the lack of organization, where you really can't take advantage of your greatest asset because they're just not executing. They executed a couple plays very well, but for the most part, they just haven't taken advantage of this great team speed.
And you can see that a lot of these players, skilled players that are highlighted here, are seniors. So I could see if it was a young team, but if their objective is to maximize their record, they're really out in front of their execution scheme and coaching to this degree. But McMillan back to pass, looking downfield.
They got him. They got him.
Sacked.
That's Nick Moore. Nick Moore. And Nick is not 100% either. I talked to Nick's dad. Nick's dad is a Union graduate. And seem to be a lot of Union graduates around here. We talked a little Union football, and Nick's a little dinged up, but he's playing one heck of a game.
Timeout, Cambridge, 30-second timeout.
All right, Cambridge calls a timeout with 5:19 to go. It's not going to get any easier next week. Unfortunately, I'm not going to be with you next week. I'm going to be in Seattle.
That's why it's not going to get any easier.
Now, Henry Morris. Now, is Henry senior or Henry junior going to be?
The young number 12.
Young number 12, former quarterback for AB and for Bentley College, is going to be in the commentator's chair next week.
Hopefully we'll talk about some of those great plays that Henry.
Oh, Henry made some highlight. Boy, what a highlight reel he could put together. Natick is a very, very skilled team.
McMillan in trouble.
They
on
got
the
him. They got him. Colin Estes. Colin Estes, and we're talking sack.
And Velez's wide open again down the sideline, but he couldn't square his shoulder. You wonder why they rolled that way.
That's a double sack. That's a hacky sack.
The right-handed quarterback, they're rolling left, and they're basically running a tear pattern downfield.
Right, and there's no way he can get the ball downfield at that angle.
You know, he may be. I've coached some kids in Pop Warner where they, even the right-handed, they're better when they roll left.
Really?
You know, the square of the shoulder helps them square up or whatever, so every once in a while you get some straight.
But he was 40 yards. Normally, he was 40 yards downfield, though.
You really have to, yeah. You know, you got to square up big time to make that throw.
Well, let's see. Let's see if they're at fourth down and 15. Let's see if they go to Velez again.
Here we are. We're 20 yards off the ball to Velez. And it's complete.
What a great tackle. Sapanaro.
Sapanaro did a Superman play there.
Totally legal, beautiful hit on Booker.
Sapp's going to Hollywood on that. He was in the air flying.
And we've got Gabe Cormier down right now. He might have another cramp. Looks like another cramp. I can feel his pain. I've after playing a lot of racquetball, sometimes in the middle of the night, I can get a cramp and you can't get rid of it.
Yeah.
And you're just hopping around the bedroom trying to get out of it. It's painful.
Very painful.
And I don't have Mr. C at my house either.
Oh. Here we go.
Okay, this is the third cramp stretch for Mr. C. I think this may be a record for Mr. C. I'm not sure.
I think so.
Yeah, this may tie his record.
You know, we have a lot of yards on the ground, and Mr. C's got a lot of decramping time in this game. You know, when Mr. C does that, you don't hear, it's very quiet. It's almost like a Zen move or something. It's very quiet. It's like yoga out there.
Yeah, no, it's like yogurt, yes. Well, we've got over 300 yards rushing at this point, or close to it.
Wow. Look at that. And
Will Henry, stat man, is going to be adding up our rushing yardage. And there's go Gabe.
Gimping.
Yeah, he's
a little gimpy coming off the line, but a tremendous game so far from Gabe Cormier. All right, the Colonials first and 10 on the Falcons 45-yard line.
We've got 320 yards rushing.
Wow.
First and 10 on the 34 for the Colonials.
Talk about change of pace. It was
on the 44, correct.
First half. Now it's from near the rest.
Here it is, another 36 power.
Jonathan, a 36 power run by 36. That's Jonathan Mandel.
And what you know is great there, he hit, you know, a Falcon player. Instead of going down, and a lot of runners, you know, just go down, he just stopped and kept pushing, and his knees were about 2 inches above the ground and kept going. Another two yards.
I have to think, you know, because every AB runner does that. I mean, they're coached up to do that. Just absorb that first hit. Don't go down. Keep your legs churning.
And yards instead of yak, it's yards after first hit.
Right. Yuff. Yuff. And they're taking all the time in the world. They just called a timeout. The play clock was running down. And we're down to 3:16, and we're pretty much playing out the string right now. Yeah.
It's good to get a breather here. Make sure your ball carriers are getting a drink. Make sure you get, you know, your strength to hold on to the football. And
now next week we're going to be facing Troy Flutie, and you'll never guess. Take a guess. You'll never guess what college he is committed to.
Let's see.
Take a wild guess.
Does it have a bird as a mascot?
Yes.
Boy, the BC Eagles. You know.
Troy Flutie is committed to the Boston College Eagles, but they don't project him as a quarterback. They actually project him as a receiver or a defensive back.
You know, and I wish in college these offensive linemen weren't so tall, because there's so many 6-foot world-class quarterback athletes that these days don't get a chance to play quarterback anymore as they get to the next level. Except for Russell Wilson in Seattle.
Right. Fran Tarkenton had a pretty good career.
Yep. All right, another 35 power out, breaking out.
Wow, look at Jonathan Mandel. Whoa, two nice runs by Mandel.
What a nice cut.
He showed some good speed there.
Nice to see a senior come on the field and contribute, step right in on a very solid run.
Number 36, John
and
Mandel.
Matt Cotter, quarterback.
Junior.
One of the 12 Cotter brothers who play for AB.
Up the middle, what a, just a violent run. Up the middle goes
That's our Kyle super soft.
Kyle Tobin.
We're gonna call him our super soft.
23, Kyle Tobin on the run.
Just the way he runs that time is just,
yeah,
it was
and
violence.
You know what, he's enthusiastic. He likes to play football. You can just tell just by watching him, looking at him, seeing how he finishes off that run, a lot of enthusiasm.
Wow, a run up the middle, met with some Falcon resistance, goes number 20,
Joe Murphy. Yep, Joe's a junior. And they are substituting freely now.
1:52 to go in the game, 34-18 Colonials. And the night has stayed dry so far, just assuming we can get to the car and pack up all this equipment.
Yeah, this is great. I expected lightning and wind and hail and pestilence and all kinds of serpents and everything. This is wonderful.
I brought my raft.
Yeah. This is take a knee. We're going to just
here.
Take a knee and play it out, not go for any more scores.
Which is the classy thing to do for AB. And we had, you can see the potential of this Cambridge Falcon team. First of all, I just want to say my hat's off. It was a very cleanly played game tonight by both teams. A great student athlete performance, always like to see. And it's great to see high school football like this. But the scouting report, the explosiveness of this team, it's just fun to watch. And then, of course, on the AB side, collecting our just our execution in that first quarter, just feeling ourselves out. But once we got there, The offensive line execution was tremendous tonight.
Yeah, I was very, very impressed by the O-line. Very athletic line. And this should be the last play of the game, about 30 seconds to go. And that should do it.
24 seconds and counting. And
AB, 1-0, 1-0 on the year.
In Division 1A against these big-time schools, as the blue and gold get off to a great start. There are two teams playing tonight as we opened up. It was the Patriots and the Colonials. The first round draft choice is to watch the Colonials, of course. So thank you very much. Mark, have a great trip.
Hey, great. I'm going to see you at the Westford game in a couple of weeks at home. And great getting back into it with you, Tim.
All right, we'll see you next week at 8.
Thank you for coming.